How to Save Your Marriage 101 2021. Welcome. My name is Ingrid Felton, and thank you for joining me today. Happy New Year. It's another year. It's a 5-year, the year of the aughts. None of that stuff matters when you're in a relationship that is going left. You don't really care about other people's problems, other people's issues, as much as you care about how to make it through your relationship and how to get back to the place where you once were. I'm here to tell you how to save your relationship. This is not a guarantee. Don't look at me and think I'm some guru that can magically snap my fingers or click my heels like Dorothy and you're happy-go-lucky. There are three things that are required in helping you to save your relationship. There are three words, actually. The first word is acknowledgement. The second word is acceptance. And the third word is action. Acknowledgement, acceptance, and action. Most people that come to me for relationship counseling, when I'm talking to them, the first thing is that they have come to a place where they acknowledge that there's a problem. Most relationships don't acknowledge they have a problem until there's really a bigger problem. You know, it's that whole thing about the cure versus prevention. I'm a firm believer in prevention rather than coming for the cure. There's no problem coming for the cure. Come, please come to me. I have wisdom, I have knowledge, and I want to help you. But acknowledging that there's a problem is the first sign in a relationship towards healing. If you don't acknowledge there's a problem, if you don't speak out loud, if you don't share with the other person that you think there's a problem, but you sit down there and let the problem become insurmountable, then sometimes it gets to a place where it's too late. Why not address the molehill before it becomes a mountain? That's the whole preventative thing I'm talking about. Acknowledging that something is not right, something changed, your wife changed, your husband changed, your partner is acting different, your partner's behavior is changing. I mean, a lot of times it's not as easy because even if you acknowledge it, there's then the other issue of trying to communicate that with the other person, and there's not always reciprocity. That person may not always want to hear what you have to say. That person may always also put aside what you have to say. And that's not a good thing because then the communication is shut down and you even acknowledging the problem doesn't allow you to communicate effectively with your partner. So let's put a little addendum there. You acknowledge that there's a problem. You share the problem with your partner. And you make sure that when you're sharing the problem with your partner that you reinforce that you believe this is an issue. You can even document it because a lot of people, a lot of times in relationships, one partner or the other doesn't remember the conversation or they say, I don't remember that happening. So documentation sometimes is good. So you know what, let me send you a text or an email saying that this is what we spoke about today. And let's follow up on this. Let's come back to this place because this is a conversation worth having, because the fact that I'm bringing this to you, that I acknowledge that there's a problem, means that I want open dialogue. And of course, some of us, you know, our relationships with people or partners that don't like to communicate or don't know how to effectively communicate how they're feeling. But that should not stop one person or any of you from acknowledging that there's a problem. The second thing is accepting that problem. And that's where the whole communication leads to, you know, a further dialogue. In accepting the problem, you have to accept the truth about the situation. You need to accept that something really is different about this relationship. Something really has changed in the dynamic of your communication or your communication styles or how you interact with each other. Why sit down there and stew over someone not talking to you when you can tell someone or have a dialogue about why you're not talking to me? Why should you accept and just not care and just check out because you know what, you don't know how to get through to your partner. So rather than try to find a way to get through to them, you decide to shut down. Most of the times when people get to me for counseling, that has already occurred. There's a shutdown in communication. Your backs are towards each other and you don't want to talk to each other because at this point you've accepted that, you know, not talking is easier than actually addressing the issue. Acceptance is a big part of the second process because in accepting that there's a problem, you also have to accept the truth. What is the truth? How do you get to the truth about the problem? I mean, it's very difficult. Again, I say, when there's a breakdown in communication in a relationship, it is very difficult to get to the truth because One person or the other does not necessarily want to discuss the truth. So how do you save your marriage? You have to accept the truth. You have to realize that without this acceptance of this truth, you can't move forward to the next action. You cannot move forward to fix the problem. Identifying the problem is half the battle. If you cannot identify what the issue is, then you can't fix it. And for most people in relationships, they know what the issue is. They understand what the problem is. But the biggest problem is how to address the knowledge that they have gotten by acknowledging the problem. So you accept that there's an issue, you accept the truth of the issue, then what? You have to take action. And most people stall here. Most people do not want to take action because they don't either don't want to precipitate the action, or they're unsure how their partner might consider the action that they want to propose. And it becomes you stall and stall and stall. And then 3 years into the relationship, you realize, you know what, I'm at a place where I've stalled so much that now I'm at a place where it's too late. You can't do anything. I wish that people would come together before it gets too late. I wish that people would address their relationships before it becomes something of a past. Relationships are work. You know, when you get to the altar and you have that great day with the white dress and the groom standing next to you and you're exchanging vows, that's just the beginning. It's not the end. It's the beginning of a time when you can share each other, but this is the beginning where you are now about to learn each other. It takes a lifetime to learn someone. There are people who've been married 40, 50, and 60 years and have gotten divorced. And during that divorce, they're saying, you know, I didn't know the other person, or I realized the person that I got to know, I didn't like. You know, you can know someone now, but you will never know that person unless you really learn that person. And learning that person means you're going to have to tolerate things about that person that you may not like, or things that you don't want to acknowledge about the person. Growing together is important. Growing apart is not a thing. Growing apart means that a relationship is going to end. Relationships only work as long as both people are getting something from the relationship. The moment one person decides they're not going to get anything out of that relationship, the relationship is fragile and it is in danger of breaking. So at some point, you both need to understand if you're on the same page and do check-ins. You know, I think marriage is something where you, or relationships are something where you should check in with each other. Every 6 months or a year, checking with each other. Well, how do you feel? You know, let's talk about the issues here. Let's ask questions. People don't ask enough questions. It's like they take for granted so many things and they refuse to ask questions of the other person. Well, what do you think about me? And I know men, you know, men from Mars, women from Venus, that thing is applicable a lot of times in relationship, because most men don't want to answer difficult questions. You know, I have a theory. And my theory is not something that is new. I think it was proven in biblical times, when in the Garden of Eden, when that God put, you know, Adam to sleep, and he took the rib, you know, and he took Adam's rib and created woman. I think what he took from Adam was his feminine aspect. And when the Bible talks about two coming together and becoming one, it is a reconnection of those two elements, the feminine spirit that was removed from Adam and the masculine spirit of Adam coming back together and being reunited. If you learn to celebrate each other's strengths instead of focusing on each other's differences, you can save your marriage. If you accept that the other person is who they are, and respect that person's individuality instead of trying to control that person or trying to have that person become like you so that you can exist in the world that you created a long time before you met that person, you will learn the value, the true value of growing together. I hope that these things I shared today with you are a help. I think that saving a marriage is a thing, is a real thing, is something that can be done. I've saved some marriages. And I think that those marriages were saved because people are committed to the process, not the process of staying together, but the process of growing together. If you choose to grow together, if you see yourself with this person 10 years, 20 years down the road, if you see them with no hair, no teeth, and you know, you still feel a sense of love, then commit to that person. Commit to the process of your marriage or your relationship. but more importantly, commit to the process of growing together. Because growing together means that you have to learn to accept each other's differences as well as each other's similarities. People separate not because of their similarities. They separate because of their differences. My name is Ingrid Felton. Thank you as always for joining me. I hope that this year I bring more wisdom and more valuable nuggets to you that can help you in your journey and it can help you in your relationships. Please subscribe to the videos, tell your friends about it, encourage others to come as well. Like the videos, leave your comments below. And again, thank you. And I hope that you have a truly happy new year. Bye-bye.